Dr. Ott, as a grandparent and as a parent and as a former minister, I know that at least in my generation, we read all these statistics about the ready availability of internet pornography and the frequent usage of internet, and makes us really nervous about what's going on and how this is shaping the expectations, minds, and behaviors of our children. Can you share a little bit for us how we should understand this and what, if anything, we should try to move towards?
Well, I mean, I think the first thing to say is that, yes, many teenagers are using internet pornography. Not everyone, again, but many, and boys tend to view internet-based pornography far more often than young women do. So it's out there. It's not something we should avoid. It's something we should be talking about. There's also another level of kinds of pornography that people are talking about. I don't know that I would put it in the same category, but some people call things like selfies or sexting a form of self-made pornography. And in a way it is. Often legally, it's handled in the same manner. So that's an important distinction to make, especially for our teens. But a few of the things we do know about internet pornography is that because it's rapid fire, because you can see the images so much more quickly and you can piece them together, it's just more accessible, that a lot of the studies done on individuals who have used an excessive amount of internet pornography do show shifts in their brain that look like addiction. So it's possible, and it really can become a problem. So talking about it early, where are kids going for their sexuality information? Why would they choose to go to a pornographic site instead of a helpful, educational, resourceful site? That's one step, giving kids good sites to go to so they're not Googling, so that they don't find pornography. But I also think it's extremely important just to take the issue head on, which is that pornography is producing images of people that aren't real. It's made up. It's just like the airbrushing on magazines. It's either people who have cosmetically altered themselves or the ways in which the cameras are being used. And so young men who use pornography regularly report that they have unrealistic expectations about their own body image, about the body image of young women, about the kind of sexual behaviors they'll engage in. So it's actually destroying the ways in which they could have healthy sexual relationships instead of helping them. They might think, oh, this is going to help me have a great sex life, when in fact it's doing the exact opposite to them because they have completely unrealistic standards that aren't possible. The other thing I think, when we sort of see both pornography but also the shift to the self-made pornography, kids who are sexting or sending images, it's just a simple question. So if God created you and God created all those other people that you're looking at, are you looking at them in a way that's valuing their bodies? I mean, to me, that's the difference between lust and appreciating God's creation. I mean, I might look at someone and say, wow, that is a beautiful person. But I do that because I'm appreciating the beauty of God's creation. I'm not denigrating them. I'm seeing them as a human being. When you watch pornography, especially pornography that's abusive and shows women in demeaning positions, that is not affirming their human dignity. It's not even seeing them as a human being. And the same might be true if you choose to cut up pieces of your body and just send certain pictures of yourself. You're sexualizing your own body in a way that's not affirming the dignity and the creation that God gave you to care for. And so I think that's the way, especially when I'm talking with teens, that I always approach the issue.